All right, today we're looking at an example involving the application of an exponential derivative, specifically looking at optimization. Our learning goals are the same as the last time we worked on applications, and I'm using headphones this time, so hopefully you don't have to hear my pen on my screen today. Couple of quick little reminders. So we've learned this week about the derivative of the exponential function. And remember that we can actually figure out the derivatives for all forms as long as we know this particular one. Because if it's base e, it just creates a special example of this. And if your exponent is just x, well then the derivative of x is 1. So that also works itself out nicely. So if you're going to like focus on remembering something for derivatives of exponentials, this is the one to remember. And so we get that the derivative of f will be the function repeated times ln of the base b times the derivative of g. So this is chain rule, right? This part here is the exponential part, and it's finished up with chain rule the same as anything else. So g of x is inside the function, so we always multiply by the derivative of that piece that's inside the function. And the other piece we're recalling is that we know how to deal with optimization already. So there's actually nothing really new in this lesson, just a slightly different way of looking at some of our things. And we also will know a little bit less about what these functions look like. So it's really important that we know how to apply derivatives here. So this could be a time where if you'd like, you can pause and reread through the reminders here for optimization. And a reminder for working on context problems like this, that the three read strategy is a good one to take as an approach. If you're going to use that strategy, you read through the question the first time, just looking for the general gist of what is this question about. And in this case, if you were to read through it, you'd notice that it's about studying for an exam. Then the second time you read through, you're looking for what is the question actually asking us for. This is an important one because often we start looking for key info before we know what the question is, because questions are so often at the very end of our description in mathematics. So knowing what the question is before you look for the key info is great. And then, of course, the third read-through is to find the key info. So the effectiveness of studying for an exam depends on the hours the student studies for. They've done some experiments and they've come up with a model that puts the effectiveness E on a scale from 0 to 10. Where T is the number of hours spent studying. If a student has up to 30 hours for studying, how many hours are needed for maximum effectiveness? So we can see this is an optimization question because it's asking us for a maximum. So we're going to be able to apply our understanding of optimization to this question. The first thing we want to do is to check to see what restriction we need on the domain of our model. In context, there's almost always going to be a restriction, so this should always be your first consideration because it's going to help you figure out A, what some of the points are that you need to consider, but also B, what's going to be reasonable for an answer here. So in this case, since the student can only spend up to 30 hours, it makes sense that there's going to be a maximum on the number of hours, and also you can't not study. Well, you can at 0 hours, but you can't do it in negative hours. That would be impossible. So our model can be written with the restriction that T has to be between 0 and 30. So since we're looking for an optimization point here, we know we're going to need to consider the endpoints because endpoints could always be higher than an actual extrema. But we also need to figure out if there is an extrema within that domain. So the first thing we're going to do is take the derivative of our function with respect to t. And we've got a constant times the function. And we know that using derivative rules, that will be the constant times the derivative of the inside. And then the derivative of a constant is 0, so the 10 ends up not having a factor here. So we just need to worry about the derivative of t times e to the negative t over 20. So we actually have a piece in here that we have to use the product rule for. So I'm going to use the first part times the derivative of the second part. So we need the derivative of e to the negative t over 20, which we know will be the function repeated, times ln of the base, which in this case is ln e, and ln e is equal to 1. So we don't need to worry about that. And again, that's why I said that we can just remember that one particular rule from the previous slide. And then multiplied by the derivative of the exponent. So the derivative of negative 1/20 t is in fact just negative 1/20. Okay, and then we need to add it to the derivative of the first part. So the derivative of t is 1 times the second part. So there's our derivative, and now we want to see if we can solve to figure out when this will be 0. So we're going to start by seeing if any of this will factor nicely. And it looks like we have an e to the negative t over 20 in both terms. So let's factor that out. And it's going to leave us with negative 1/20 t plus 1. Excuse me. So since we have our derivative now, and it's in a nice factored form, that's really handy because we know that now we can take advantage of the zero product principle, because the critical points are where the derivative is 0. So in fact, we get two potential results here. We need to consider if there's a spot where this can be 0. And where this might be 0. Now, a number raised to an exponent can never be 0, so this first part has no solution. And this is just a linear term, so we're going to get equals negative 1 and multiply, because we subtracted 1 from both sides. Now we're going to multiply both sides by negative 20. So we get t equals 20. So we actually have one extrema to consider here, so one critical number. And then we also need to make sure we consider the endpoints, because we don't know what this function looks like, so it's possible that at 0 or at 30, it's going to end up being higher than 20. It could turn out that 20 is a minimum. So we need to evaluate the function at 0. Which this part is 0, because 0 times anything is 0. So half of 10 is 5, so the effectiveness will be 5. And I would guess that this seems reasonable, since you would probably have some knowledge of what you're studying for, because you've worked through the whole course. So there's definitely some logic there. And we want to know what it's going to be at 20. E to the negative 20 over 20, so that's e to the negative 1. And we can plug that into our calculator. And this will turn out to be approximately 8.7. And we're going to do the same with 30, right? Substitute in t equals 30, plug that into your calculator, and you'll get that it's approximately 8.3. So it does turn out that at 20 we have a maximum. So it looks like that is going to be our solution. It makes sense that spending a lot of time, like going to our maximum number of hours, is probably going to start to lose effectiveness, right? Eventually we've studied everything that we need to. So going beyond what we need to study actually kind of like you're spending too much time on it. You're going to end up forgetting things from before. And so there does come a point where studying is too much. So there's definitely some logic in this answer. And all of our answers are between 0 and 10, which we were told in the question is where the effectiveness could lie. So therefore, student needs to spend 20 hours studying for the examination. Now, this in no way necessarily is indicative of what you need for any particular ones of your exams in your life. This is based on some studies, of course, but every student is different, and the way you study could be a huge factor here. So if you actually have questions about studying in general, you should reach out to your teacher for some tips. A lot of people think studying math means just practicing, but if we're practicing errors, then we're not actually doing something productive. So there are other things that we should consider when preparing for mathematics exams.